Hello, my name's Lizzie, and welcome to this series of kit videos by CADARN. Today, we're going to be looking at the Canon Legria Mini. Now, I'm going to go through everything you need to know to use this camera. I will mention a few technical things, but I'm not interested in getting under the bonnet. What I want to do is make sure that you have the confidence to pick this thing up and go out and shoot. So, to help you navigate this video, we've designed a few chapter markers or chapter buttons. So, if you want to skip forward, or if you want to review something later, you can use some of the buttons here beside me on the screen. The Legria is a very easy to use camera designed for video bloggers. So to start things off, let's put the battery in, shall we? Here's the battery. Here we have the battery door here. Open it up like that. Here's the battery, and you slip it in like that. It's clicking there, so it fits. Close the battery door. Right now, so we can turn it on now. This is the on-off button. There we go. And you can see the little light comes on, the screen comes on eventually, and the lens cap opens. So have a look at the lens. As you can see, it bulges out a little bit. That's because it's a fisheye lens. And the fisheye lens gives you this super wide view, like this. So the super wide view is really good if you want to capture a lab or a seminar or something where there's a lot of action going on in a big space. Do watch out, however, if you're shooting yourself in this fisheye look and you get too close, you're going to get a nose that's all out of proportion. You're going to look a bit weird. It is a look some people like. I don't. So if you want to zoom in and get a more medium kind of shot, then you can press this zoom button right here. Okay, and as you can see, that's a flatter look. You lose the fisheye aspect, but do bear in mind that you also lose a little bit of quality when you zoom in like that. So the super wide fisheye and the medium close shot are the only two focal lengths that this camera offers. The camera is also designed for selfies. So you've got this really amazing screen that you can move around, and you flip it over, and there you go, I'm looking at myself. Great if you want to do a talking head, or maybe a walking and talking head.
Like this, which is great because I can show you the environment.
Getting some unusual shots is really easy with this camera because it's so small and portable, and you can take it anywhere. You can take it with you if you're going out. You can also put it in some very unusual or interesting positions like this. The camera fits really easily into the palm of your hand, and it's quite easy to hold steady, especially if you put your elbows on a table like this. But the quality of your clips, the quality of your footage is always improved if you have stability. So I would always recommend that you use the camera's inbuilt stand like this. It's very versatile, and you can shoot at lots of different angles, and some are quite interesting angles. If you want a little bit more height than the camera's inbuilt stand provides, you can always use this GorillaPod, which is provided in the pack. So the GorillaPod is quite tricky to use until you realise that you've got to take this little bit off. So you do that by fiddling around with here. This is unlocked, pressing that button and pulling it off like that. Then you've got to put this on the camera in this screw attachment here. And you can use a penny to tighten it on. Make sure it's tight so that it doesn't wobble around. There we go, it's nice and tight. Put your legs out, I guess. Then you stick it on like that until it clicks. And then for extra security, make sure that you lock it. And there you go, you've got a little bit of extra height, but of course, be very careful that your shot's not wonky, because it's very easy to be wonky on a GorillaPod. The GorillaPod is more than just a tripod though. You can use these legs to do anything you want, and you can wrap around things like maybe a tree branch or a music stand and get some really interesting and unusual angles. You could also use a proper tripod like this one, because the screw attachment on the bottom of the Legria is universal to all tripods. Now, to help you, make sure that your shot's not wonky. There is a very helpful on-screen marker, and I'll tell you more about that later on in the video, in the menu other section. You can click on the button there if you want to go there now. Okay, let's have a closer look now at your screen. This little icon here is your battery life. Now, when your battery is fully charged, you can expect the camera to run for about 50 minutes when you're recording, and it will run for double that time when you're in playback mode. Now, that's not very long, so you should always remember to fully charge your battery before you go out and shoot, and take your charger with you, because it is very useful to have. You do have the option to charge or run the camera off the mains, and that's the little hole there, but the cable is not included. It's an optional extra. There is a USB cable that's provided that you connect here, but you cannot run the Legria off your computer, and you cannot charge your battery off your computer either. Okay, so let's go back to the screen. This little icon tells you that you've got your SD card in the camera. And here it is. This is the slot. What you've got in here is an 8 GB mini SD card. And 8 GB gives you about 40 minutes, or a little over 40 minutes of recording time at the camera's highest setting. And you can see these numbers here. That shows you how much time you have on your card left to shoot. This number here, 25p, refers to your frame rate. 25 is how many frames you're going to be shooting every second, and the P means progressive, and that means that you're shooting full photos, just like with celluloid film. So this number here, 24 megabits per second, refers to the quality of the file, the video file that you're creating. This is the highest setting in the camera, and I recommend that you keep it at 24 megabits. This L stands for large, and that's the quality of the photos that you can take with the camera, and that's the highest setting, and this is the number of photos that you could take onto your card. Just a little tip, when you zoom in, the quality of your photo automatically goes down, and as you can see, the L has turned to an M, which means medium. By the way, if you want to take a photo, you press this button right here. Pressing it. And it has to make that little noise, or else the photo is not taken. Okay, back to the screen. This little icon here means that face detection has been switched on. And that means that the camera is going to focus on and follow any face that it sees. You'll notice that it has detected a face because it will put little brackets around the face. And this is quite a useful thing to have because it's the only way that you can help this camera focus. This little icon means that something called detect orientation is turned on. It's not very important, so I'd recommend you just keep it on. So this is another button that I recommend that you ignore. It allows you to add both still and animated graphics to the screen while you're recording. So what you could do is you could write on it, or you could add little stars that explode on the screen. I really do think that if you want to add graphics to your screen or to your video, that you should do it when you're editing. If you do it now when you're recording, you can't control what you're doing as well, so you're not going to get the effect that you want. Also, you can't change your mind. You can't take it off once it's on there. So I really recommend that you steer clear of that button. This button lets you choose your shooting mode. As you can see, there are lots of different choices. For different situations, I recommend that you keep it either in auto or you go to P. There you go, I've selected it by tapping on it. P stands for programmed automatic, and on this camera it lets you select your exposure like this. You pick where you want to concentrate. You pick the section of your screen that is the bit you want to expose on, and then it lets you darken it or lighten it like that. There you go, I'm setting it a bit darker. So P also lets you select your white balance. There's the white balance button there, WB for white balance. You set your white balance to make sure that the color of what you're shooting is correct. The white is white, and the blues are blue, and the greens are green. as you can see, there are lots of different selections here. This is auto white balance, and the camera's going to do it for you. This is for when you're shooting in sunshine, in daylight. This is when you're shooting in certain lights indoors. And this is custom white balance, which means that you can set it manually yourself. And this is how you do it. You can see there's a little square inside the screen. Make sure that square is full of something that is white. Then you press the set white balance button. It's going to flash a little bit. And there you go, it is set. I have set my custom white balance manually and everything looks correct and lovely and balanced in my screen. This button here leads you to all the camera's menus. There you go. Now if you scroll along to this menu, you get all the camera's audio settings, the audio scene is what they call it. Now we've done tests on all of these settings. And we would recommend, highly recommend, that you stay in standard sound. That's the STD, like that. The other modes deal with the audio in quite heavy-handed ways. For instance, this is what speech mode sounds like. It doesn't sound very good, does it? This menu here is also interesting. It's special recording modes. Now, the Legria lets you record in several different ways. What you've got here is a normal recording. Then you can go on to interval recording. Now, interval recording lets you record time-lapse, like this. Please remember that when you're shooting a time-lapse, stability is essential. You're not going to get very good results at all if your camera's moving around. So stick it on a tripod and leave it there and let it get on with its work. So when you've selected interval recording, you've got a little message here. Okay. And you can see this little icon on the screen that means interval recording. And there's a number after it, which stands for 5 seconds. So what that means is that the camera will take snapshots every 5 seconds at 5 second intervals. And then it will put these snapshots together to make a sequence. And that's how you get your time lapse. Now you can change the length of the interval between snapshots by pressing this button here. There you go, you've got several selections, 10 seconds, 30 seconds, 1 minute and 10 minutes. And what you select really depends on the length of the action that you want to shoot. Just a little tip, you have to press this playback button here on the side when you want to stop recording a time lapse. And that's the only way you can do it. Right, so we're back in the special record modes. And here they've got a slow motion function as well. So the way a camera records slow motion is by taking more shots per second and then playing those shots back at a rate of 25 frames per second, the normal rate. And that means that the shots are elongated and it looks like it's in slow motion. In this camera, the only way it can do that is by reducing the quality of the image. So I'm going to select that now and you can see the slow-mo icon and then that's at half speed. So if you are at half speed, the quality of the image is reduced by half. And if you're at a quarter speed, it's reduced by a quarter. That's the only way this camera can do it. So just be aware of that if you're using slow motion. Back into special record modes. And what we have here is a fast motion. And that's a pretty cool effect. But you know, you can easily add that kind of effect in post when you're doing your editing, so there really is no point to adding that effect in camera because it's easily done when you're editing. Okay, so that's most of the interesting things that are in the menu, but let's go over the rest of it quickly and you can explore in your own time. This is the other settings menu and it's got things like your video quality, the brightness of your screen, there you go, and you know, languages, things like that. This is a useful thing, on-screen markers. There are quite a few things here, you want to explore them. The main things are, here you've got a 16:9 marker, and that shows you what is actually going to be shot when you press the record button and you shoot a video. The whole screen is only used when you're taking a photo. This is another useful one, this is the level, and when you select that, you've got this line across the middle of your screen like that, and that helps you make sure that your shot is not wonky, especially when you're recording landscapes. And there's one more on-screen marker down here, which is a grid. Now the grid is going to be helpful if you want to line up several things in your shot. Or if you want help with your composition and putting things in the right place on the screen. Okay, and the other things on the menu are, you've got this flip rotate image menu, and it's got its own explanations on the screen there. This is the self timer, and that basically allows you to leave a 2 second or a 10 second interval before the camera starts recording. Once you've pressed the red button, you can start recording. And then you've got here the remote control and streaming function. Now that's because the Legria has Wi-Fi, which means that you can connect up to it using your phone or your pad or your tablet, should you want to do that. Now there's only one more thing I need to tell you about the screen, and that's how to record. Yes, you guessed it, it's that little red button right there. That's how you make it start recording. Press it and it goes square, and the little numbers come up here to tell you how long you've been recording. Press it again to stop recording. Now that's the only record button that you have on the camera. And just a little tip, while you're recording, you cannot use the zoom button. You can't zoom in or zoom out. And that's probably a good thing, because you know, it'd look pretty bad if you zoomed in during a shot. So when you've recorded something or taken a photo, what you want to do is be able to view the files that you have created. And you do that by pressing this little blue button here on the side. Press it and it goes into playback mode. You can also use this blue button to turn the camera on in playback mode without using the on-off switch and opening the lens cap. Let's try that. There you go, it's turned on. So when you press the button, the camera automatically goes into movie playback. And you can see here all these thumbnails. These are your clips. And you can scroll along and find the video clip that you want to view. Now you can see that there are some grey slots on this screen, and there are no video files in these slots, and yet I can still scroll along and find more clips. That's because of the way that the camera files its clips. It puts things into folders. So this screen here that you can see is one folder, and there are only 4 video clips in that folder. Whereas if I scroll along here, that's another folder and it has 6 clips in, so it hasn't got any grey slots. The way that the camera creates these folders seems to be quite random, but it looks like it's something to do with when you shoot them. So if you're shooting a whole load of clips in the morning, they're going to go into one folder, and then when you go on to shoot in the afternoon, they'll go into a different folder. This is very useful when it comes to organizing your clips, and I'll talk a bit more about that later. So to view a clip, you tap on the thumbnail and it will play. Tap on screen again, and all these playback controls come up. Now, I find these playback controls really fiddly to use, even with my small fingers. And the same goes really for everything on the camera, all the on-screen controls and the icons and the buttons. They are quite fiddly to use, and people with big fingers are gonna have a hard time, I think. Anyway, there we go, playback controls. If you press stop, you go back to the thumbnails. If you press pause, the video will pause and all the playback controls will stay on the screen, which means you have more time to look at them. Now, most of these you'll be familiar with, so I'm not going to go through them all, and you can play around with them in your own time. I will mention a few things though. The first is this loop button. It's a very useful button. If you press it, the video will play again when it reaches the end, so it will just play in a continuous loop. Now that's quite useful, because if you don't have that button on, once the clip has finished, it won't stop, it will just keep on playing the next clip and the next clip and the next clip. And I find that very confusing, because I don't know what clip it's playing. It'll only stop when it reaches the end of all the clips that you have on your card. Another thing that's confusing is that if you press pause in the middle of a clip and then go back to your thumbnails, if you want to play that clip again, it won't start at the beginning, but it will start from where you left off. So to get to the beginning, you have to press this button here and skip back to the beginning. I just think that's a bit confusing. This button might also be useful for you. It allows you to take a picture of the frame that you've paused on, but bear in mind that the photo will still have this black letterboxing. It will still be in 16:9. I also want to mention this edit button, which is also only available when video is paused. When you press it, you have two options. One of them is trim, and that allows you to trim the beginning or the end off your clip so you can shorten it and cut off any bits that are useless to you. It also allows you to delete the clip. So let's get back to the thumbnails by pressing the stop button here. Now you can see that we also have an edit button on the thumbnail screen, but it does slightly different things. It gives you two options. One is to convert to MPEG-4 and the other is to delete. Now converting to MPEG-4 means that you can add filters or join clips together. So say you've trimmed your clips to the length that you want them and then you want to join them all together into one file or one video. You can do that in camera. It's called in-camera editing. I really would recommend that you don't do this. In-camera editing is really fiddly and you don't have much control, you don't have many options. I would recommend you do it afterwards on a computer. However, it might turn out to be a useful function for you. The other thing you can do in edit is delete, and you can select to delete just one clip or all the scenes, all the clips that you have on your card. So that's quite useful. So that's movie playback. What about if you want to view your photos? Well, you have to go to the menu. So let's press the menu button here. And you scroll along and here you have photo playback. Press on there and you can view your photos. It's pretty much the same as the movie playback apart from these all photos. Just one little tip, when you tap in you can view the photo, but if you want to get back to the thumbnails you have to press this little checkered button here, and that's the only way to get back to your thumbnails. So let's have a quick look at the other things in the playback menu. You also have video snapshot, which will play back all the very short clips that you took in that shooting mode. And here at the end, you have Wi-Fi. All the options under Wi-Fi have their own explanations, so it's all pretty obvious. And I'll let you, experiment on your own if you should want to use Wi-Fi. It is really cool that you can connect this camera up wirelessly and view clips on another device or even upload footage to the internet. However, as with most things to do with playback on this camera, I would say that it's much, much easier if you just connect to a computer and get all the media off and do all your work on a computer instead of on this camera. And that leads us on seamlessly to talk about how you connect the camera up to the computer. Now, if you're not using Wi-Fi, there are two ways of doing it. The first is to connect the camera directly up to the computer using this USB cable. And this is where the USB cable connects. There you go, there's the port. Now remember, when you connect the camera up to the computer, you do have to press this blue playback button if you want the computer to recognize the camera. The other way of doing it is by taking out the SD card and plugging it directly into your computer. Obviously, this SD card is a micro SD card and it's way too tiny to fit into any computer, but we do have this adapter. You can stick it in the adapter, and some computers do have their own SD card slot and you can slot it in there. It's really easy to use. Alternatively, you can use a card reader like this. Some card readers do have micro SD slots, others do not, and therefore this comes in useful again. What happens when you connect the camera up to your computer really depends on what kind of computer you have. There'll always be a way for you to copy the media that's on your SD card over to the computer. But on some computers, you won't be able to delete the files if you're using the camera to connect to the computer. Really, the best way of doing it is to access the file structure on your SD card. Then you can find the folders that hold the images and the videos that you've shot, and you can copy those folders over to a destination of your choice. Also, I would recommend that you avoid using downloading or image browser software like this one that Canon provides. That's because the camera stores its clips in folders, and sometimes in tests that we've done, it duplicates the file numbers. So that means that the browser software or the downloading software is going to get confused, and you might get confused too. You'll find that the folders are already dated. But once you've copied them over, you can give them any name you like. However, I would recommend that you do keep dated folders and your clips are all in dated folders. That means that you avoid the problem of any duplicate clip numbers. So that's pretty much all there is to say about the Canon Legria Mini. To sum up, I'd say that it's a really great little camera. It's portable, it's versatile, it's fun, and it's really easy to use. The super wide angle lens means that it's really easy to capture all the action, and the flip screen makes it really great for selfies. On the downside, you really don't have many controls. For instance, if you want to zoom, there are only two options. Also, audio quality really isn't that good, and the battery life is a really big limitation. However, all in all, it is a very accessible and useful tool for making videos quickly and without too many barriers. So I'm looking forward to seeing what you use it for. Have fun and goodbye.